Miles Along the Road on BCTV is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Be safe this winter when the temperature.
Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm your host, Kendra Cook. The Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles is located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania, and it is home to dozens of horse-drawn carriages and motorized vehicles such as cars, trucks, and motorcycles. And if you would like to contact the Boyertown Museum, you can do that by giving us a call at 610-367-2090, or you can send us an email, mail, that's M-A-I-L, at boyertownmuseum.org, and feel free to visit our website at www.boyertownmuseum.org. The museum is open Tuesdays through Sundays, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. We are closed Mondays and most major holidays. Well, coming up at the museum, we have a couple of really neat events to share with you. The next one will be our very first Fastnacht Day in the Reading Diner, and that's going to be on Tuesday, February 17th, Fat Tuesday, as we all know, and that's from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. So with the price of regular admission, you can sit in the diner and get a Fastnacht and a cup of coffee for just 25 cents. So that will tide you over until our next diner day, which is not until April. So this is a good chance to get into the diner and enjoy the atmosphere in there for a little bit. On February 21st, which is the third Saturday of February, and as I said last time, because the museum is celebrating its 50th anniversary, we're going to be doing special events the third Saturday of every month. And in February, on the 21st, we're going to have a presentation by someone you are probably all going to recognize, Mike Inessa, who used to be a regular on our show here. Mike Inessa of Wheels in Motion will be at the museum giving us some tips on detailing and reconditioning your show car, because it's time to get those cars, start thinking about getting them out of your storage for the winter and ready for all the car shows that are going to be coming up this spring and summer and fall. And that's February 21st at 2 p.m. And in March, I know we have another show until then, but I just want to let you know, in March, our third Saturday program is going to be a Hoods Up weekend. If you come to the museum, you'll probably notice the hoods on the cars are closed, and we keep them that way for usually for a couple of reasons. But people are always asking us to see the engines, and they want to see what some of the engines look like. So if you come on the weekend of March 21st, a lot of those hoods will be open. You'll be able to get a good look at all the engines inside. And also, real quick, in April, our third Saturday event is going to be a safe driving course, which is offered by AAA. And that's Saturday, April 18th, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Now, you do have to pre-register for this, but you pre-register through the AAA Reading Berks office, not through the museum. And the phone number there, if you're interested in getting more information, is 610-374-4531. All right, there's a lot coming up this year at the museum, as you can tell. That's just a little bit. We've got a whole rest of the year to go. We've got lots of great events this year, so just keep staying tuned to this show and to our website. And if you're a Facebook person, you can go on Facebook and like the show and the museum there too, and you'll get all these updates on there as well. And a quick thank you to everyone at home. If you came to our Golden Gala in January, we want to thank you for coming. It was a really great event. We had over 150 people there. We had great food and music. We had a trivia game, and we unveiled the newest member of the museum collection, a 1913 SGV touring car, with Fleetwood Body, and I said you would not be disappointed if you came and saw it. Was anyone disappointed, Dan?
I did not hear one word of disappointment.
I think so. It's a beautiful car. Mm-hmm. So if you didn't make it to the gala, now you have to come to the museum and visit it. And it is in person. It's absolutely beautiful. So now we'll finally start with the show. And we're glad that all of you at home decided to join us here this evening. We are live the first Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. And we love to hear from our viewers at home. And the phone number here at the studio is 610-378-0426. And I'll give that number to you later. And that's when we have our car quiz. But with me tonight is Dan Olsen, as always. Hello,
yep.
Dan.
Hi.
And our guest this evening, I'm sure, is another familiar face to you all. Our guest tonight is Sam Fiorini, and I think actually you're going to be talking about things that I can't afford, probably. So,
few of us can.
Yeah. But first we're going to start off with Dan.
Yes. Okay. I'm going to be talking about Oldsmobiles, okay? And preferably we're going to start with 1949. Why 1949 is because that year is when Oldsmobile introduced the rocket engine, and it was a 303 cubic inch engine, and it was an overhead valve V8 engine, and that's the first for Oldsmobile. Everybody was going to overhead valve engines back then, late 40s, early 50s. V8s were the big thing, and so Oldsmobile had the 303 cubic inch engine, pumped out 135 horsepower. In 1949, it got a little more as the years went by. Why overhead? You know, they had flathead engines before that, but now you're going to overhead. There's some advantages. You could have a higher compression. It would be better breathing, so your air coming into the engine, your exhaust going out could flow a lot easier. More efficient combustion chamber design also. So that's kind of technical reasons for overhead advantages there. Now, the engine's designer, which was Charles Kettering, he thought the engine's potential would not be realized when they built in 1949 or whenever he designed it, which was earlier than that, of course. He thought that the gasoline quality was not good enough to get the most efficient engine. And it would be efficient when you get a 12-to-1 ratio, he was talking about, a compression ratio. But again, you need a better gas to get that kind of compression ratio. Now, we're talking 1949, 7.25-to-1 compression ratio. So there's a long ways to go to 12-to-1 ratio. Anyway, from 1949 to 53, they had the 303 cubic inch engine. 1954 to 56, they increased to 324 cubic inch. They had a larger bore, they had the same stroke, larger ports on it, better breathing yet. A little more horsepower they had on there. I'm not quite sure how much now. But anyway, so that's it. So they had a bigger engine. And question is, you know, why get engines bigger and bigger and bigger? You know, there was some competitive market back then. I mentioned a moment ago about the V8 engines. Everybody was going to V8 overhead and stuff. Racing was getting big then, too. NASCAR had its start in 48, 49, something like that, and they were building more and more, bigger and bigger, and faster cars. And I'm sure a lot of you have heard the term, win on Sunday, sell on Monday. So that's what they were doing. They could put a big engine in the car and they would win. They'd probably sell more cars on Monday. And I've heard that many times from people who are in the sales, or I've read about it, people who are in the sales departments of these corporations. Also back then, in the mid-50s, Chrysler's 300 had a 354 cubic inch Hemi pumping out 355 horsepower. Chevy came out with their 283 in 1957. They had a fuel-injected engine then. Ford, 312 cubic inch. They were supercharged. So all these car companies, I mean, Chevy and Ford were common cars, and they were coming up with the big engines and powerful engines. So Oldsmobile had the 354 to 1956. 1957, Oldsmobile had a new redesigned car for that year. And if you could show the first picture, please, we have here. Anyway, Oldsmobile had this brand new redesigned car, said the most completely redesigned Oldsmobiles in 20 years. Okay, there you go. That's a 57 Oldsmobile Golden Rocket 88. That was the cheapest model, not the cheapest model, but they had three different, I'll say models, and that was the cheaper of the three. Anyway, that's the 57 Olds Golden Rocket 88, and you could get the brand new engine for 1957, which was a 371 cubic inch engine. It was the same engine basically as the 303 and also the 324. It was just, they were progressing, they were developing it. It had an increased bore, increased stroke also, the deck height was changed, improved bottom end, a stronger engine, and that pumped out 277 horsepower in that car. Now, to even bump it up further, if we could go to the next picture, we have, they came up with this J-2 package, this option that you could get. And we're looking at the manifold with the three carburetors, three Rochester carburetors on that. And that was the J-2 Golden Rocket engine, again, based on the 371 cubic inch engine they had. That had 300 horsepower. The plain one that I showed, well, I didn't show the engine, but the plain one without that triple carburetors was 277. This increased it to 300 horsepower in 1957. It was also around for 1958, where it was the... it was 312 horsepower. J2, that was introduced mid-season, January 1957, and it gave a lot of performance there. Again, it had triple Rochester two-barrel carburetors, special intake manifold, of course, to fit those carburetors, on dual exhaust, a 10 to 1 compression ratio. And so it was kind of a pretty powerful engine there. Performance. We had performances, 0 to 60 under 8 seconds, which was very stout for back then. Quarter mile time was in the 15-second range. Top speed was around 120 miles an hour. You show the next picture there, we have a 57 Olds. That's a Starfire 98 convertible. That's the most expensive Oldsmobile that you could get, the 98. And to show the next picture is another J2. That's the whole engine there. Oops, it's kind of small. If you have real good eyes, you can see that. Anyway, that shows that it's in the engine compartment of a car, and it's the whole engine there. And I'm sorry that's small like that. Oops. Anyway, this engine here, this J2 engine, could... it was optional in any 57 or 58 Oldsmobile. It would cost you $83 for that option. So I thought that was pretty good. $83. They built approximately 2,500 of them. I don't know how many are out there anymore. I've heard of them. I saw them for sale on eBay and other online things. And I believe you could buy parts for them too. And make your own. You know, you already had the engine, you add on these parts here. And do we have a larger version of that now? Yes, there we go. Thank you. Okay, now if you could show, okay, you're looking at that. I'm going to go to the next picture now. And that will be a 58 Oldsmobile 88. There we go. And they were also in the 57, 58, both had them. 57 had 300 horsepower, 58 had 312 horsepower. Actually, the 371 stayed around till 1960, but it only had single carb. The J2 is only for 57, 58. 58, some interesting options there. It had nothing to do with the engine, but I wanted to tell you about it. One of them was called the pneumatic, spelled NEW-MATIC, Pneumatic Ride Air Suspension System. You ever hear of them,
never.
Sam? Okay.
Sorry,
they had them in GM, and they leaked like crazy, all the GM cars. And so you'd have a car, you'd park it, it would leak the air, and it would kind of sink, and it would look like a low rider. Variable ride and constant height features. Again, it leaked. It was a failure. Most of them got replaced by the factory or by the dealers. So that was and another item they had, which I have a picture of also, it's called a transportable radio. You can't really see it that well in this picture, but it's right in the middle of the dashboard. That's a 58 Oldsmobile there. Transportable radio, it was transistorized, which was big back then. It slipped into the dash, but you could take it out, and it also had battery power. So if you had a picnic or something, you just take it out, you take it with you. And I thought that was pretty cool. That was for 1958. So it was designed to operate outside of the car, had the batteries and a speaker, all built in the same little package. So that was that. Anyway, back to the J-2 racing engine here. Had a NASCAR background. Early to mid-50s, Oldsmobile was successfully raced by Buck Baker, Red Byron, and Curtis Turner. That was with the 303 engines. They were one of the better cars that were racing back in the early 50s. By 1957, all the other companies were getting better and better. I mentioned Chrysler and Ford and Chevy, how they had bigger engines and such. So what they did, they come out with the 371. They came out with the J2 option on it, and that gave you a good bump in power. Also, you could get a special competition J2 package. That cost you $385 if you won one of them. That had the engine blueprinted, which meant your tolerances were a lot tighter. It had a racing camshaft, racing pistons, solid lifters, adjustable rocker arms, and sure there's a lot of other stuff there. They needed two drivers for this. One of them was Lee Petty, who already had a championship under his belt, Richard Petty's dad, of course. The other guy they got, I saw this written, and I could not confirm it. I usually try to find two sources to confirm it, but the other one was Ralph Earnhardt, which was, you know, Dale Earnhardt's dad, Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s grandfather, of course. So that was the two factory drivers they had. 57, Oldsmobile won four races. Petty won all four of those. 1958, Oldsmobile won seven races. Petty won all of them. In 1958, Petty actually won the championship in an Oldsmobile. In 1959, he also won driving Oldsmobile in Plymouth. Now, there was a ban that went into racing with the Automobile Manufacturers Association. All the companies said, we're getting out of racing. So Oldsmobile pulled all their factory sponsorship and all that stuff, and Petty went on by himself, just kept the Oldsmobile and continued racing there. Now back then they raced on the beach down in Daytona. They also had like speed trials, and the Oldsmobile hit 144 miles an hour, and Bill France, who's in charge of NASCAR, took one look at that. It was 20 miles an hour faster than everything else at size, and he banned the car. Now I don't know exactly what he banned on it, but they made something illegal, but he ended up still winning races, so I don't quite understand that. Halfway through 1957, NASCAR then banned multiple carburation, so they had to go only to one carburetor again. So Petty stayed with them. The AMA racing ban, factories pulled out. There was a lot of pressure from the public. There was, you know, they did not want to promote speed and consequently injuries and death and that sort of thing. So that was it. I mentioned Oldsmobile produced only 57, 58, so they stopped producing the J2 option. They kept the engine going for another couple years after that. So the last picture here, if you show that, there are J2 engines still around. There's one of them right there. I saw this truck at Hershey, of all places. Hershey with the stone stock vehicles. This is parked here. It's a 32 Ford. Pickup truck, and that's a J2 Oldsmobile engine in that thing. That truck is beautiful, and they were selling T-shirts. I had to get one. Of course, I got one with that on the back. So that was a really nice truck there. And a little side note before I go back to you, Kendra, and I came across this. Go on Google and you type in J-2 rocket. Okay, this is the rocket engine. J-2 is the name. Okay. NASA has a J-2 rocket engine. You know, the people going up in space. And it powers the Saturn rockets that started in 1963. They're still making them today. Did you know that?
All it needed was an Olds engine.
Yeah. So it's a liquid fuel cryogenic rocket engine is the J-2. That's the NASA version.
Ooh. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I wouldn't put that in my car.
No. I don't think it would fit in your car.
Hey.
Well, wouldn't. Okay, that's it.
All right, excellent. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, and Sam, as I said, is going to talk about expensive things. Sam, what can I buy with my lottery winnings?
Well, you're going to have to win a big lottery for these cars.
Oh, man, okay.
Every year, car fanatics wait all year long for the car auctions in Scottsdale, Arizona. The three major auction houses have their auctions, and they bring the biggest and best cars there. And people come from all over the place to spend from $1,000 to $1 million to buy a car. Can you put the slide up there? With each passing year, the record prices are paid for these cars, and truly rare cars go to high bidders that are very special. This month I put together the record holders, the cars that have garnered the highest recorded bids among the top brands. This is not a list of the 10 most expensive cars ever, because that list would be boring. There would be three brands. Instead of that, I've gathered the 10 top brands and the most expensive cars from each of those. At number 10, I have Alfa Romeo. Most Americans think of Alfa Romeo for little sporty cars like the Spider. Modern Alfa Romeos, since about 1960, have been mass-produced sporty cars and sporty coupes and sedans and convertibles. Prior to 1960, and going all the way back to 1910, most Alfas were exotic high-performance cars. They were rare and expensive. Financier Nicola Romeo left the company in 1928, and the company was absorbed by the government in 1933. It was in that year that the company produced this, the Alfa Romeo 8C 2300 Monza. The 8C, or 8-cylinder line, started in 1931 and ran through 1939 under a number of different body styles and three different displacements. This is the 2366cc version, the smallest. Chassis number 2311218 wears the body built by Brianza, a supercharged 8-cylinder engine of 2,866 cc's, a replacement engine, and it had a number of successful races, including a second-place finish at the San Romeo race in 1947. It continued to race up to 2010. That's a 77-year career for this car.
What year in 40-something?
It raced in 40. It came in second in 47.
47. Wow.
At that point, that was a 19-year-old car.
Yeah. Well, I figured a ones in 2000 is probably vintage racing, though.
Right.
Yeah.
The Alfa Romeo 8C 2300, chassis number 2311218, with its original engine among its spare parts, rolled across the blocks at the Gooding & Company auction at Pebble Beach, California, in August of 2010. The final hammer price was recorded as $6.7 million, or the equivalent of about $7.3 million today. Next, we move on to the British Isles, where Walter Owen Bentley, or W.O. as he was known, was an engineer in the early 20th century. He apprenticed on the railroads in England, where he learned to design and make complex machinery. He tried motorcycle racing, where he rode for the Indian Motorcycle Racing Team. Eventually, he and his brother built up a shop to sell French cars, and by World War I, they were designing and building aluminum radial engines for airplanes. After the war, the Bentley brothers opened their own business, and the first Bentley motor car hit the road in 1920. To promote and improve the cars, they took them racing and raced successfully in hill climbs and long distance races, even taking 13th in 1922 in the Indianapolis 500 and fourth place in a 23 Le Mans race. The company went into financial difficulties and W.O. had to give up ownership of the company. But in 27, he came up with the 4.5-liter model, and adding a supercharger, this car was known as the Blower Bentley. Of the 720 4.5-liter cars built between 27 and 31, 55 had superchargers. And they built that many to race them at Le Mans. and it raced really well. It started in 27, it won in 28, and took second in 29. But it was this chassis number, HB342, known as Bentley Blower Number 1, that holds the record as the most expensive Bentley. This is Sir Henry Tim Birkin's car, and he did development work on the supercharger. Initially, the two-seater had a lightweight fabric body, and it caught fire during a race, but it didn't stop Birkin from racing. The car was later rebodied in a single-seat aluminum body and painted red like this one here. Blower Bentley Number 1 was sold after Birkin's death in 1933 and changed hands a few times over the next decades. In 2012, the Bonhams Auction House sold this at the Goodwood Festival of Speed for £3.5 million, making it the most expensive British-built car ever to that point. But just ahead of Bentley on the list was a car built by the future owner of Bentley Motors. Charles Rolls sold cars and Henry Royce built cars, and the pair joined up to build the Rolls-Royce, and it quickly climbed to the top of the heap of cars. Their engineering and quality was without peer. Rolls-Royce production began with number 20151, and it was delivered to the namesake of the Singer Sewing Machine Company. A month later, number 2 was delivered, and a month after that, number 3, and this is number 4, number 20154. It's the oldest surviving Rolls-Royce. Wow. Powered by a two-cylinder 1.8-liter engine and joined to a three-speed transmission, the 10-horsepower car has always been rare. Only 17 were built. This one was first displayed at the 1904 Paris Auto Show and then shipped up to the Olympia Motor Exposition in London 2 months later. No fewer than 6 owners had this car between then and 1930 when it was retired. 2 decades later, the car was discovered, and as the story goes, in a barn, and it was sold and restored. After a 4-year restoration, it was shown various times and traded hands a few more times, and eventually made its way to the Bonhams Auction in London in December of 2007, where it sold for £3.5 million, or just about $8.2 million. In eighth place, we have another connection from both sides of the Atlantic Ocean. Carroll Shelby was a race car driver, starting with a little MG in the early 50s and peaking with the win in the 24-hour Le Mans in 59. But in 59, Shelby had health problems and had to retire from racing. So he started teaching racing and decided to import his own cars. So he was importing the AC brand from England to the United States. His version, though, replaced the 6-cylinder British engine with the Ford V8, and it became the Cobra. Shelby developed his car into a number of variations, including the Daytona Cobra Coupe. Bodied in Italy, this car was designed to race in the GT class where it competed against Ferrari. And on July 4th, 1965, the Shelby Daytona Coupe CSX 2601 beat the Ferraris. At one point, this car was owned by a North Dakota gasoline distributor who had the car licensed and drove it on the street to his gas stations to collect receipts. I'm sure they heard him coming for miles. In May of 2009, Mecum Auctions in Indianapolis sold this car for $7.25 million, making it the most expensive American car sold to that point. It's been rumored that 2601 was resold for $8 million to an owner in South America, but one of the 6 Daytona Coupes, CSX 2287, is on display at the Simeon Museum in Philadelphia, and you can see it today. But it did not bring the $8.5 million that this one did. We have another British car at number 6. Bruce McLaren was a successful race driver in the 50s and 60s. He had 27 podium finishes and 4 wins in his 100 starts. After racing for many years, he decided to build cars, and his cars were just as good. In 67, it won 5 of 6 races. In 68, it won 4 of 6. And in 69, it went undefeated, even finishing 1-2-3 in 2 races. But Bruce McLaren was killed in a race in 1970, and his name still lives on in cars. In 1989, McLaren Automotive was formed to create the street cars from the technology they had learned in 3 decades of racing. And 3 years later, the McLaren F1 entered production. Its unique 3-seat arrangement, where the driver sat ahead and in the middle of the 2 passengers, was positioned the driver like a Formula One car. BMW provided the 6.1-liter V12 engine, which produced, at the time, an astonishing 600-plus horsepower. And the car's lightweight pushed the car into the record books, clocking it at 243 miles an hour.
It's quick.
Your car can do that?
No.
It can't.
No.
Production ended in 98 with 100 cars being built. The cars are so rare and desirable that these cars that originally cost about $1 million were appreciating in value almost immediately. This one, McLaren chassis 066, in original condition with 13,900 miles on it, sold at Pebble Beach in 2013 for $8.4 million, or about $8.6 today. And other cars, including number 31, which has 1,000 miles on it, was offered for sale last year, but it didn't sell for even more money than this. Which brings us to the top five, including three of my favorite brands, and starting off with Duesenberg. Fred and August Duesenberg started building cars under their own name in 1913 and racing them shortly thereafter. Famous World War I flying ace Eddie Rickenbacker raced to 10th place in 1914 in one of these cars. And Duesenberg was the first American to win at the French Grand Prix in Le Mans. In 1920, the brothers decided to build a car for the street, and did they ever. From 1920 to 1937, fewer than 1,200 Duesenbergs were produced. But their reputation as the best cars you could aspire to own led to the coining of the phrase, "It's a doozy." Mm-hmm. At the top of these was the fantastic J460, also known as the Whittle Coupe, named for its first owner, George Whittle. The elegant and powerful Model J Duesenberg was offered in short and long wheelbase versions with and without a supercharger. The engine in this car is a 420 cubic inch, double overhead cam, 32 valve, straight eight with one carburetor, producing 265 horsepower. J460, however, rides on a long wheelbase and on chassis number 2478 and carries the bodywork from Murphy of Pasadena. Winning awards in Concours events like Pebble Beach and Amelia Island, this black two-seat coupe is fitted with an aluminum roof and flashy orange paint on the brakes and under the fenders. Rare among Duesenbergs, the J460 was one of 12 fitted with the freewheeling transmission option, which Whittle apparently burned out decades ago.
What was the wheelbase length in that again?
It's around 140 inches, I believe.
Yeah, and seats two people,
and
right?
Two people.
Okay.
That's what you need.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Needs a rumble seat.
As with McLaren, this record-setting sale will most likely be topped in the near future. Rarer and more desirable models, such as the supercharged SJ model, will push the prices into the atmosphere. But for now, J460 holds the record from a 2011 auction, where it sold for $10.3 million, or about $10.8 today.
Oh my gosh!
Told you, you need a big lottery.
Dan, you and I can go halfsies on it, right?
Oh yeah. Right.
At number four, a brand you might not expect to see on the list, Ford. Duesenberg has a racing history at Le Mans, but the 24-hour race, which started in 23, didn't have an American car winning the race for 40 years. But the story on how Ford won Le Mans is one of my favorites. Henry Ford II wanted to buy Ferrari in the early 1960s. Enzo was negotiating with Ford until he learned that the road car division would fall entirely under Ford's control. Having lost the battle, Henry decided he would win the war. Henry the Deuce called a team from Ford and laid out a plan to build a car that would take on Ferrari. The goal was to beat Ferrari at Le Mans. After the meeting, one of the engineers ran after his boss and said, "You didn't give us the budget." Henry's reported reply was, "I didn't," and he kept going. This team developed the legendary GT40, which hit the racing circuit in 64. Although it led a number of laps at Le Mans, and its first season was not remarkable. 65, Carroll Shelby took over the program, and the GT40 won its first race at Daytona. The Mark II came out in 66, co-driven by Bruce McLaren, and the car finally won Le Mans. But Henry wasn't happy when the victory wasn't American enough for the officials, with the British-based Lola chassis and its drivers from New Zealand. Ford took the program back in-house, scrapped the whole car, and started over. Ford brought the Mark IV to Le Mans in 67, this time driven by A.J. Foyt and Dan Gurney. Nobody could argue about the Americanness of the Mark IV, which won the race, and another Mark IV finished fourth. GT40 would take second and third in 68, first, second, and third in 68, as well as 1st, 3rd, and 6th in 69. This particular GT40 started its life as a 1968 Mirage race car, chassis number M1-1003. Rule changes prevented the Mirage from running at Le Mans, so the car was converted into a GT40, carrying chassis number P1074. The car raced in the 68 season and won race the following year, but in 1970 it was sold to David Brown, who leased the car to Steve McQueen. P1074 became one of the camera cars in the movie Le Mans, allowing sequences to be filmed at speed. Before its sale in August 2012, RM Auctions estimated the selling price at $2.3 to $2.7 million, and they were way off. With inflation, this car sold for $11 million. With inflation, that's about $11.3 million. So at number three, we have something completely different. While known for its racing cars, Ettore Bugatti built some of the finest cars before World War II, but the story of his car starts at the dinner party. When the discussion arose who built the most luxurious cars, one female dinner guest agreed that Bugattis were fast automobiles, but Rolls-Royce made the finest cars. Ettore set out to prove her wrong. The resulting cars were given the designation Type 41 and christened Royale. While 25 were planned, only 6 were built, and even worse, only 3 were sold. Bugatti designed the car with an enormous straight-eight engine with an overhead camshaft and 3 valves per cylinder. The Royale's 300-horsepower engine was 12.7 liters, or 779 cubic inches,
wow,
which was actually smaller than the 15-liter prototype that was too big. The engine is 4.5 feet long and 3.5 feet tall. And so they had to build a big car to fit around it. Of the 3 that were unsold, 2 of them, including this one, chassis number 41.141, were traded to American race car driver Briggs Cunningham in 1950 for $571, the equivalent of about $5,600 today, and 2 refrigerators. Apparently, it was hard to get a refrigerator in France.
That makes perfect sense.
It was extremely hard to get a new refrigerator in France in 1950. Cunningham spent $3,000 to restore this car. Here's a picture of all 6 Royales in one place, the only time they ever showed up in one place, which was in Pebble Beach in the 80s. This car, called the Kellner car, had the highest official price for one of the cars selling. One of the cars in this list reportedly sold for $20 million to Volkswagen in 2000, when Volkswagen bought the Bugatti brand. Mm. But that wasn't official. The official price of this Bugatti was $9.8 million, or about $20 million today.
Mm.
Yeah, we're no longer talking about just cars here. They're rolling sculptures. They should be treated like a Van Gogh painting rather than a car you drive to work. So the number 2 car is actually currently a TV star. It's featured in the latest Mercedes commercials, selling a $30,000 sedan. The W196 is not something you'd see on the road cruising down 222. Mercedes developed the W196 as an open-wheeled racing car for the Formula One season in 1954. Driven by racing legends Juan Manuel Fangio and Stirling Moss, the car won 9 of 12 races and took the world championships in 54 and 55. In the middle of the car's domination of Formula One, Mercedes had a devastating accident at the 55 Le Mans race, where a Mercedes 300 SL hit another car and soared off the course, crashed with such an impact that the driver and 83 spectators were killed. Another 120 were injured. Mm. This accident put an end to Mercedes racing, and with it, the W196 program. Of all the 196s built, only one is in private hands. This is chassis number 196-010-006-54. And it rolled across the Bonhams auction in July of 2013 at the Goodwood Festival of Speed, and bidding ended at £19.7 million, or the equivalent of about $30 million.
My God.
Hmm. So at the top of our list is Ferrari. And if this were a list of the top 10 highest priced cars, like I said, it would be boring. Of the top 10, 2 would be Bugatti Royales, 1 would be the Mercedes, and 7 would be Ferraris. And if I extended the list to the top 20, 8 more would be Ferraris.
Wow.
So like many Ferraris, this one has roots in racing. Ferrari made plans to compete in the FIA's Group 3 Grand Touring car series. And in order to compete, Ferrari needed to produce or homologate the car. From 62 to 64, they produced the Ferrari 250 GTO. GTO stands for Gran Turismo Omologato, or homologation, for Grand Touring. Numbers at this time in Ferrari names describe the displacement of one cylinder of the engine. So the GTO, the 250 GTO's V12 engine has 250 cc's per cylinder, or 3 liters. And the all-aluminum overhead cam engine with a modern dry sump and low, for low center of gravity and 6 Weber carburetors. There you go. Yeah. Put 6 Webers on that one. Kicks out 300 horsepower. When new, the American buyer would need to put down $18,000, or the equivalent of about $140,000, to buy this car. In the short 3-year run, Ferrari produced 39 of these. Every magazine has rated this car as one of the most beautiful or one of the most spectacular sports cars or Ferraris of all time. And this particular GTO has a racing history. Driven by Henri Ulreiler, the car finished second behind another GTO in a 62 race. In October that year, Ulreiler was behind the wheel of this GTO again when, on reportedly worn tires on a rough race course, during the race, one of the tires blew, flipping the car over and nearly breaking it in half, but killing the driver. Mm. Ferrari took the car back and restored it and returned it to private hands. It's had one owner from 65 to 2010. The 64 Ferrari GTO sold privately in 2012 for a reported $52 million. But since that cannot be absolutely verified, the record is held by chassis number 3851 GT. At the Bonhams auction in August 2014, this car brought an amazing $38 million. So while the records are going to keep going, these are the most expensive cars at the moment.
It's kind of staggering.
Yeah.
It is. You know, I bought something on eBay recently, and I spent a little bit over $100 on it, and I thought I was like really
it hurt a little,
wild.
Didn't it?
Yeah,
I'm looking
at this. You imagine buying a $38 million car?
I wouldn't mind having the money.
Wow, it's amazing that it can be sustained. But
yeah.
I'm sure you're right. The records will be broken. Keep on being broken. Thanks, Sam. And now we're at the car quiz portion of our program. So again, the number here at the studio is 610-378-0426. And Dan, you're gonna throw some car pictures up there and see if you can stump our home viewers this evening.
So let's show the first one. There we go.
Ooh.
Guess what that is? What can I tell you about this? I took that picture on a cloudy day.
At Macungie?
Yes,
that narrows
it
down.
Yep. Yeah, it's Macungie. It's all GM show. That car has since been repainted. I know Kendra knows the owner. I know the owner of this. He has it repainted, and when it was being repainted or right after, they said, oh, that's not the right color. I guess when he first took it to a show after repainting it, mm-hmm. they said, oh, that Chevy didn't really make, oh, I just gave it away. They didn't make colors like that. And he lifted the hood, and underneath, everything was still original, you know, rusty and everything. And he says, well, there's the original color. So
was it originally a two-tone like that?
It was, yes. And he kept it that way.
Is that a lower trim level?
It is. It is. It's a, Dorier Day this past year, too. So.
Oh, good, too.
Okay, home viewer, what is that?
I'd say it's a 56 Chevy, Dan.
Okay,
maybe
what?
Maybe a 210 series.
What makes you think it's a 210?
That looks like on the cheaper side, so.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
It could be a Bel Air, but I think it's a 210.
Okay. All right, well, thanks. We have another caller. See if he guesses the same.
Okay, have a very good show. Enjoy it, Dan.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Do we have another viewer there?
Sounds like it.
Yes, we have another viewer.
Oh, yes. Yes.
I would call it a 56 Chevrolet, and I guess the fellow before called it a 210, and I believe it's a 210 because... let's see, a 150 would have a little less chrome on it than that, and I think a 57 would have a little bit more in the back.
Yep.
Another sweep there.
Yeah, but you're both right there. It is a 210, 56 Chevy 210. Mm-hmm. So did you have one, or are you just a fan and you know what
no,
they are?
No, I never had a 55, 6 to 7 Chevy.
Okay.
No.
You know, here's a question for you. What was the gas cap on these things?
Was the gas cap on them?
Yeah.
Under the left taillight.
You got it. Yeah.
A little lever that you turned, you drop the taillight, and you put the gas in.
You got it.
Right, yes.
When I was a kid, we had a 57 Chevy, and it had the chrome piece there moved, and I always thought that was cool. And 57.
Yes.
So, okay.
Yeah, 57, you turn the thing to the one side. I forget which way you turn, but from the outside, I guess you turned it. You're looking at it, it'll be counterclockwise, I would think.
Okay. Well, thanks for calling then.
All right. Well, it was fun. It's always fun.
All right. We have fun too.
Okay. All right. Well, let's see if we can do another one.
All right. Thanks for calling again.
Thank you.
Now, you know what's interesting else about these cars is I was looking stuff up for this. Backup lights was an option. What is it? Brakes. Okay. Power steering, power brakes. They had options back then. I didn't know they had them on Chevys back, you know, even as an option. But backup lights, maybe a turn signal, and I don't know. They had some interesting options back then that we take for granted today. And also de-icing wiper blades. I'm not sure. I never heard of that. And it's like, oh, I have to investigate that.
Yes, we do.
Yes, okay. Anyway, next picture, please.
Writing it down, Dan.
All right, let's see. Where is that one taken? I'm trying to think. I know where that is. Okay. You could get air conditioning for this car. $427 would cost you.
It's about the price of the car.
It's about a quarter of the price, yeah. That car costs $1,967 brand new. So it's a six-cylinder. That might be the cheapest of that make that they made that year. Except that's a four-door. Two-door sedan is probably cheaper.
Two-door coupe, business coupe.
There you go, business coupe. So anybody out there know what that is?
I just wrote about the year before this.
Mm-hmm. Backup lights were optional, as I mentioned, on this car. Turn signals were optional on this. Turn signals were optional, and I saw a figure, 96.9 of these cars in that year had turn signals. So if you find one without, you got a rare one. Okay, we have a home viewer. What is that?
Well, I would call that a 1956 Plymouth.
Okay. Plymouth what?
Okay.
I got you.
I don't know. My memory is a little short there.
Okay.
I would say that's probably the middle one.
Okay. That's a 56 Plymouth Savoy.
Okay. Yes.
I'm trying to. I can't remember what the cheaper one was now.
I think do some thinking about that.
I think
that.
It was Belvedere was the top one, and Savoy, and I don't know. But now, so that's what that is. That one has the six cylinders I mentioned. That is one of 151,762 Savoys made that year. Option on these was the Highway Hi Fi. Are you familiar with that?
No.
Okay, that was the record player in those cars.
Oh, okay.
You ever see one in it? Once in a while, I'll see one of them at a show, and it's kind of a cool thing there. So.
I think using your phone is distracted driving. Try flipping over a 45.
Yeah. Okay, well, thanks for calling.
All right, well, okay, it's fun again.
All right, yeah.
I'll call you when I recognize something else.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Now, there's another option on that car. It was a PowerFlite transmission, which was the automatic transmission with push buttons. So we were talking about push button transmission before we went on the air. So
we were.
Yeah, our SGV at the museum, which you should all come and look at, mm-hmm. has push-button transmission on, sort of.
Yeah.
So, okay, next picture then. Please, there you go. I'm thinking that's Hershey there. It's in the car corral.
Yeah.
There's that ubiquitous curb behind it. Okay, wow, what do we got here?
We should do it instead of car quiz. Guess where I took this photo. Yeah. That should be part of the answer, I think. Yeah.
This was the second least expensive car by this make for that year. So that has a V8 engine. If you had a six-cylinder, it would be the cheapest car by that make in that year. Okay, we got a home viewer again.
Okay, we have a home viewer.
I recognize this voice.
I would call that a 1954 Ford.
Right.
And that would be, I guess, a mainline.
You got it. Right on there.
All right. Yeah,
it is a mainline. That's a business coupe there. That has no rear seat on it.
Shorter roof.
What was that?
It has a shorter roof.
Yep, shorter roof. And I get excited about business coupes because you just don't see them that much. I think they were basically run into the ground. And,
Yeah.
That's what they were there for. They were to haul your sample case around and go from house to house or business to business. And
yes, right. Okay.
Okay. So now, are you familiar with this car, or again, you just kind of identify because you're a fan?
No, I remember them. Let me see. My wife, before we got married, had a 1954 Mercury.
Okay.
And then we kept that one. And I had sold all my Oldsmobiles. Mm-hmm. And that was it. Then the next car we bought was a 59 Ford.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And, of course, these are all used cars, well used.
Yep.
Yeah.
One of the things about these Fords, this 54, was when they had the Skyliner, which was the glass roof on it in the front half.
Uh-huh, yeah.
That's probably all the way at the opposite end of this car, though, as far as price.
Well, I think that was a little newer. Wasn't that around 56?
No, it was 54.
Okay.
The 56 style, they had them in then, too. They had them in both those styles. So.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Well,
thanks for calling again.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. Take care. God bless.
Yep. Thank you.
All right. I think that's it for car quiz. But I see one that we didn't get you yet, Dan. I want that next time.
Oh,
yeah.
That one?
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay.
Uh-huh. I have the cheat sheet back here. Anyway, again, thank you, Dan and Sam, for joining us this evening. We appreciate it. Thank all of you at home for joining us. And don't forget to visit us at the museum, whether you do that in person at 85 South Walnut Street. We hope that you do, because you really do got to check out that SGV.
Oh, yeah.
And mm-hmm. You know what? Wait till next week, because the Bantam will be back, too. We also have a Bantam that's been at the Philly Auto mm-hmm. Show this week. So you can go visit that, mm-hmm. and then you can come visit us again next week.
Okay.
Until then, we'll see you all in March.
Okay. Yep. Wake up.